Welcome to Green Pond Baptist Church. We're glad that you're here. We are going to ask you to stand, if you would. We are going to sing a song called Come, Now is the Time to Worship. Perhaps you've heard of it, but the lyrics are very easy to learn and understand, and they'll be on the screen right behind us. So join in as we lift praises to the Lord. Savior, we thank you for the privilege we have of coming into your house. What a blessing that is. May that never become old hat or just routine, but it would be a love from the depths of our hearts that we have the blessing and the privilege and the joy. And when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord, I was glad. May that be our heart's cry today.
be with the service and all that happens here. And Father, be with those that may still be on their way. Help us to love you and adore you the way that we should. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Good morning, all. Good to see everybody. Everybody happy?
Amen.
Good place to be on Sunday morning.
Amen.
Welcome, Brother Coach. Just glad to have you. Looking forward to the message this morning. A few announcements this morning. Remember, Tuesday is Lady Bible Study at 10 o'clock. They have about 10, anywhere from 10 to 20 ladies. So y'all come on out and join them for that. And Wednesday we have the Bible study at 6:30. So the coach going to be bringing the message there. He gave us a great one last Wednesday, so we're looking forward to that. And then also the kids club will be meeting there. So don't forget to bring the kids with you in that. And Friday morning we're having a Bible study at John Skeen's house at 8 o'clock. Inviting all the men who like to come out there for that. And remember, Saturday is the memorial service for Miss Gladys. And fall festival meeting next Sunday. So if you're interested in helping with the fall festival, plan on staying a little bit for that. And then there's also going to be a church clean out for inside, outside. So we need all the women and men that's available to come back, be on the 26th of Saturday there. And I think that's about all we got in the announcements and all. So if our ushers would come forward, we'd turn it over to Shorty and y'all come on up.
Well, good morning. How in the world are you?
Well,
are you glad to be here?
Amen.
Man, I'm excited that you're here. Thank you for honoring the Lord with your presence in His house. And you look over at that piano, Miss Sharon's not there. So we can be singing back to the disc today. And we've been having a little bit of trouble up there, haven't we, Matt? Just imagine we've been working on this. We had to change a little bit. Maybe the invitation hymn will be changed. But anyhow, we're excited you're here. You leave that door open, all kind of important people come in. The guy I hadn't seen in a long time walked in. I said, well, tell me who you are. He knew me. He said, you're Shorty Boy. I said, yeah. He used to be about this big around. Alan, where are you at, boy?
I'm right here.
Yeah, there he is back there. Hiding behind this. I couldn't see you, buddy. A bunch of his family is here. Thank you. Y'all remember Martin Lane. This is his son, Alan. He brought a bunch of his grandchildren and children. And so we're happy about that. Any other visitors? We haven't been here in a long time. We're happy you're here. And we're just so blessed. I'm supposed to be singing instead of talking, right? And I don't get paid to talk. So I mess up when I even stick my foot in my mouth when I talk. But anyway, we are going to be singing out of if you prefer to use your hymnal 189, I have a time getting used to this here. Taking the offer, we usually up sing and do it kind of like we did it last week. It's hard to teach an old dog a new trick. But anyhow, we're going to be taking the offering while we sing. But we're going to ask, Benny, come here a minute, brother. I want you to ask God's blessings on the tithes and the offerings. And you would please, and then we'll begin our singing.
Heavenly Father, we do thank you for this day. Thank you, Heavenly Father. We had the opportunity to come to your house and worship you. And Heavenly Father, we just ask now that you bless this offering. And bless everyone here, Heavenly Father. We ask all this in Jesus' precious and holy name. Amen.
Amen. All right, let's see if we can crank that thing up. 189, the Lily of the Valley.
Thank you.
Sharon, where are you at? There she comes, going to be sharing a good old song with us this morning.
I have to get my cheat sheet with big letters.
Thank you for the people who are blessings in our lives. I have not stopped giving thanks to God for you, Green Church, Green Pond family. It is people like you who matter so much. People like you matter to us and always will. Thank you for your wonderful retirement gift, but more importantly, thank you for your love and service all these years. Always in our hearts and prayers, love and appreciation, Pastor Cheek and Melissa.
Shelter, save me, the only.
Call me,
As I said to the deacons the other night, I'd rather get six phone calls about somebody going to the hospital than zero. I can minister to you very little if I don't know there's a need for ministry. So, and that would be true of a regular pastor that you had. I have occasionally, in 55 years of ministry, I have occasionally been accused of not going to the hospital to see somebody who was sick, and I said I didn't know they were even there. So you can't do something about what you don't know, can you? So please, if you need me yourself, or if you know somebody who does, please let me know. Romans chapter 1 this morning, beginning in verse number 8, familiar verses Paul is writing. And as he writes to that church, listen again to familiar passage about what he is saying as he writes to the church in Rome. Romans chapter 1, beginning in verse number 8. He says, "First, I thank my God through Jesus Christ for you all, that your faith is spoken of throughout the whole world." Now, that one statement is amazing in itself. He said, "I am thanking God," he says, "that all of you, for your faith is spoken of throughout the whole world. For God is my witness, whom I serve with my spirit in the gospel of his Son, that without ceasing I make mention of you always in my prayer, making a request, if by any means, now at length, I may have a prosperous journey by the will of God to come unto you. For I long to see you, that I may impart unto you some spiritual gift to the end, that you may be established. That is, that I may be comforted together with you by the mutual faith, both of you and me. Now, I would not have you ignorant, brethren, that oftentimes I purposed, he says, to come unto you, but was left hitherto, that I might have some fruit among you also, even as among other Gentiles. I am a debtor both to the Greeks and to the barbarians, both to the wise and the unwise." And so, and here's how I know that Paul was a Southern Baptist, because listen to the language. "And so much as in me is, I am ready to preach the gospel to you that are at Rome also." I read somewhere that people only really want to go to church four times in their life. When they're babies and they're born, their babies are born, they want to come to church. When they get married, they generally want to come to church. When they're sick, they generally want to be about the church people and somebody to pray for them. And when somebody dies, they want to be brought to the church. So really what that says is, in other words, when they're hatched, matched, scratched, and snatched. That's the four times people generally want to come to church. After the church one Sunday, the preacher was shaking hands of the people that were coming out. And as he was coming out, this one fellow came by him and he pulled him to the side. He said, "Brother, come over here just a minute." He said, I would like to recruit you," he says, "in the army of the Lord." And he said, "Well, preacher, I'm already in the army of the Lord." And he says, "Well, if you're in the army of the Lord," he says, "how come the only time I ever see you is at Christmas and at Easter?" He said, "Because I'm in the Secret Service." Well, we got a lot of them on the roll that are in the Secret Service, don't we? Any church, not only this one, but there's always somebody in the Secret Service. And there are a lot of people today, and I don't know when I've read so many articles over the last 6 or 8 months or so, that though many people think of America as a Christian nation, and journalists will proclaim over and over again about how we are the most religious nation on the earth, there are a large number of folks that are unchurched. A large number of people who don't bother to go to the church at all. Some who used to come, who no longer come. And the sad part of that is many of our young people, once they get away from the influence of home, I told people I've been in church all my life, and I said I didn't want to go all the time, but I said when I was a kid, you know, Mom and Dad said, "Well, yeah, you're going." We got parents now who say, "Well, kids, if you want to stay home, it's okay." And I don't understand that philosophy, really. Maybe I'm too old-fashioned when it comes to that, but I remember for a long time my mom and dad would carry me to church, and sent me out at the church, and they didn't go. They would come back and get me after, you know, church was over. It was a long time before my mom and dad really started going to church themselves. There are a lot of people today that when you run into them, or you would have asked them if you were standing in front of them this morning, and you ask them if they are a Christian, they would probably say to you that yes, they are. If you followed that up and you said, okay, you're a Christian, but tell me, what church do you belong to? And then they say to you, well, I don't really belong to any church. I don't go to any particular church. I'm not a part of any particular church. I do a lot of funerals in Lakeland and Bartow for some of the funeral homes where people are needing a minister for one reason or another. Maybe their minister is retired. Maybe he's passed and gone on. The majority of the ones I do, people say they're religious, but they don't have a church, so they need a pastor to do the funeral. I had one recently, and I always ask when I'm talking to a family that I don't know, and I said, well, what about your brother, mother, sister, whatever it may be? I said, were they a religious person? Were they a part of the church? Were they born again? Were they a child of God? And most of the time, the answer that I get anymore is, well, mom or dad or so-and-so were religious. Well, I got news for you. The devil's religious. Doesn't mean he's going to heaven. I don't think he's going to make it. But it's kind of sad that we live in a day and age when people will say they're religious, but they don't have anything to do with religion in terms of the church and God and the Bible and what it has to say. They're way off somewhere else. And then there are a lot of people that used to belong to the church but no longer attend for whatever reason. And it's kind of what, if you were looking in your bulletin this morning, it's kind of what I call the church going blues. There are a lot of people that have the church going blues. Why is it that believers who are once active in church one day find themselves without any active connection to a local body of believers? There are many answers to that, probably as many answers as there are unchurched people. But we got so many folks out there, some former church members, maybe they say, you know, well, there are too many hypocrites in the church. Some may say, well, the church is just after your money. Well, if I'm around here long enough and fill in long enough, I do have a sermon entitled, "The Church Really Is Just After Your Money." And we'll deal with that one Sunday. Some may say, well, the church is boring or it's irrelevant. Many say, well, the preacher said something that offended me, or maybe they had a problem or a need, and they say, well, the church failed me. The church let me down, and they didn't respond to me. Maybe they didn't feel like they really belonged to a certain group or any group in particular. So they sent home for all kinds of reasons. Now, I asked the folks on Wednesday night how many of them were Johnny Cash fans. Some of them confessed. And some of them didn't. But I have a song here that I've done it's to the tune of the Folsom Prison Blues. And so I call it the Church Going Blues Song. And so, for better or worse, here we go. If I see folks leaving, I'll know to stop that way. I woke up on Sunday, bed was nice and warm. Supposed to get up early, but I hit the snooze alarm. You may think I'm lazy, but I got bad news. My doctor diagnosed me with the church going blues. I used to get up early to get a back row seat. Somebody got there before me. He had me beat, so I had to move up to the front row pew. That's when I started feeling those old church going blues. I used to be real active, used to volunteer, sitting on committees, and I set up lots of chairs, but it burned me out. I started feeling used. Now I chair just one committee for the church going blues. I used to sing those church hymns. I stood out in the crowd. I sang them nice and pretty. Well, at least I sang them loud. Then they changed them all, and I was not amused. Now the only tune I care for is a church going blues. I used to like a sermon. It really packed a punch. We got out pretty early, beat the Methodist to lunch. Then he drug it out, and I began to snooze. the preacher went and gave me those old church going blues. CDs be on sale next Sunday, right? The one thing we don't want to get and allow to come into our lives is to get the church going blue, because Jesus came, the Bible said, to build his church, and he died for the church, and the New Testament is written to the church and for his church. And so when you and I came to know Christ, we were baptized into Christ, into his body, which is the church. And the church shouldn't be just a little part of our lives. It's not a club. It's not a hobby. The church, the Bible says, is to be a force that you and I can come and learn the Word of God and about the Word of God and about the God of the Word, and we tell others about Him and we bring others into the body of Christ. Amen. So when we come to Romans, it's an amazing book. I told folks before that they told me I could only have one book of the Bible. I couldn't have any of the rest. The rest would be destroyed. I could only have one book. I would pick the book of Romans because it has a plan of salvation. It has every major doctrine of the Bible in it. It has everything you need to become a Christian and to live the Christian life.
Amen.
And so Paul is writing to the people in Rome. And it's amazing. He writes, and in this first chapter he is saying, I have a strong desire, he says, to come and to visit with you, to be for you with a while. He says, I've been praying to God and asking God to make it possible for me to come to your church in Rome. He longed to see that church. He planned to go there many times. He wanted to go to church. In other words, Paul had the very opposite of the church going blues. Paul said, I want to go and be with you. Now, I want us to think for a minute, because in being here, I want to try to address the church, what the church is about, what we're be doing in the church. And one of the first things I wanted to look at is what characterizes the feelings about a church. Now, in these verses, there are basically five reasons that Paul was so excited about going to church, about going to Rome in particular. And so we're going to be dealing with some of those and looking at some of those things that Paul was excited about in terms of going to the church. The first thing I notice as he writes to them here is their great faith content. Their great faith content. Paul says, and listen to this, he says, you have a reputation of faith that is being reported all over the world. Can you imagine if the reputation of Green Pond Baptist Church to all of the surrounding area, just the surrounding area, maybe in the lake and other places, is that you have a reputation for great faith. When somebody thinks about you, when somebody calls your name, when somebody says, hey, what about that Green Pond Baptist Church up there? What do you know about them? Well, I'll tell you one thing. They're a church that has great faith. Here was a church that Paul said, all of the world, not just the local place. He said, your faith is so great and it's so strong that all over the world it is being reported. You have a great reputation for faith. Now, when Paul was writing later to the church in Corinthians, he couldn't say a great deal of good about them. They were having trouble. They were having problems. And not once in that book could Paul say, well, I can't wait to come see you folks. You've got such a great fellowship. And that'd be sad, wouldn't it? That you have a reputation to where when your name came up, nobody would want to go. Nobody would want to be a part of that. In the church in Corinth, they were not encouraging, they were discouraging. They had a reputation, you know, of fussing and fighting and slandering and aggravating people one way or another, driving people away, causing discord in the church. That was the reputation that the Corinthian church had. Paul was writing, he said, I'm not going to come see you. He said, I'm going to write you a letter, and when you straighten your mess out, I'll be down to check on you. That's not the reputation you want for your church. He said, the church at Rome, he looked at it and he said, everything I'm hearing about you is that you are a church that has great faith. Now, I know that preachers get reputation. Sometimes it's good, sometimes it's bad. But I'm here to tell you from the other standpoint, churches get reputations as well. I had a preacher friend back in North Carolina who pastored for quite a long time. but he never stayed anywhere more than 2 years. He finally got a reputation, if you're looking for a pastor to stay, don't call him. Because he didn't stay, I bet he never got all his bags unpacked. He probably had at least one suitcase he never got done. I don't know what it was, but 2 years was, I don't know, maybe he only had 2 years worth of sermons, you know, I don't know. He had to move on to something else. We get reputations. I saw a cartoon not long ago. There were two brothers laying in bed about school age. And they're laying there early in the morning talking to one another. One of the brothers said to the other, you know, if mom doesn't come and wake us up soon and get us out of bed, we're not going to make it to school on time. We don't have to wait for anybody on this one. The Bible says great faith is available. We can make that happen. Now, for a church's faith to be reported all over the world, that church has to have a specific faith. And the content of that faith must be defined by the Word of God. If you go to verse number 16, Paul says, I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ. It is a power of God unto salvation to everyone believing, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. So, as a Christian church, we are to be anchored by a principle that ensures that the content of our faith is great. A Christian church always returns to the foundation of the Word of God. It is the bedrock of our faith. It is the practice of our faith. And when the Bible speaks to an issue, we are to speak to an issue. When the Bible is silent about an issue, we need to be silent about an issue. In matters of faith, there ought to be unity within the body of Christ. In the matters of opinion, there ought to be liberty. And in all things, there ought to be love in the body of Christ. We call Bible things by Bible names and do Bible things in Bible ways. We are saved by grace through faith. That's the Bible. And the content of our faith ought to be so great that it's biblical and it's never going to change. And beware of anybody who tries to change the Word of God. Now, what does this matter of faith mean to the individual Christian? I suggest the takeaway for us this morning is that we need to read the Word of God. We need to read the Bible. Romans 10, 17, so that faith cometh by hearing, and where does the hearing come from? It comes by the Word of God. We are to live in the book. Now, most of us, I would dare say, I'm going to jump out here a little bit, I would dare say most of us here this morning read the Bible, but why don't all of us read the Bible? When I read the Bible, it says my faith will grow. I need to read it every day. If all of us actually read the Bible every day, the faith of this church would explode beyond where it is right now. Amen. Reading the Word of God, letting that God's Word strengthen you and help you to grow personally, to live the way you need to live, to draw others to Christ. Now, you might not understand or remember everything when you're reading, but it will change you from the inside out. That is the work of God in our lives, to change us from the inside out and to slowly transform you and I into the very image of God. We need to take the time to read a portion of God's Word every single day. But secondly, in here, there's also great faith action. Notice what he says in verse 8 again, chapter 1. First, I thank my God through Jesus Christ for all of you that your faith is spoken of throughout the whole world. Now, he was talking about the fact that they were motivated to accomplish things because of their faith. Listen, it is important to have right beliefs, but that's not enough. It's important to have right beliefs because what we believe, truly believe, eventually will work itself out in our actions. You see, I can say, like I said a while ago about the vote, I can tell you, well, yeah, I'm a religious man, but see how that works out in my life. I can say, well, I'm a person of faith, but I see how that works out in your life. We are a people of faith. Well, how is that working out in your life? How is it making a difference in your life and in the life of the church? Because you say you are a person of faith. One of the things that I've tried to do through my years of ministry, I spend a lot of time teaching the doctrines of the faith. The Bible says faith without works, though, is dead. It's not enough to be able to quote Scripture. It's not enough to go to Acts 2 and 38 and there's a plan of salvation. It's not enough just to offer up communion and help organize a church. All of that is important. But there's something beyond that in Galatians 5, 6. For in Jesus Christ, neither circumcision availeth anything, nor uncircumcision, but faith which works by love. The faith that we are to have for God to work out through our lives. The only thing that counts, folks, at the end of the day, is that faith is expressing itself through love as you read the Word of God. We are to build our reputation on more than just being right. Now, I'm going to make a statement that's probably not true. I can be right 100% of the time and still be wrong. Did you hear what I just said? I can be right 100% of the time and still be wrong. If I have an unloving attitude, I can be right 100% of the time and still be wrong. If I don't do what I'm supposed to do. Listen, people will drive by and go to another church besides this church as long as they can find a church that loves them. The true church is not really true unless it loves.
Amen.
I read a story about a little fellow that used to ride by. The preacher would notice on Sunday morning, he always stood at the door out here and greeted people as they were coming in, not just as they were going out after service, but as they were coming in, he greeted them. And he noticed a little fellow on a bicycle kept riding by every Sunday morning about the time he was out there greeting folks coming to church. Every Sunday riding by. One Sunday he decided to go out to the end of the wall and stop that little boy on his way as he's riding by and talk to him. And he went out and he stopped him again and talked to him. He said, young man, said, I noticed you ride by here every Sunday. He said, where are you going? And he said, well, I'm going to this church on down the road here a little ways. He said, well, why don't you stop here at our church? Why do you go down to that other church? He said, well, they just love a little fellow like me down there. Folks, people will drive by a lot of churches to go somewhere they love. Where they can feel the love of God and the Spirit of God, and the faith of God. God is not going to ask you what kind of car you drove, but He is going to ask you how many people you drove who didn't have transportation. God's not going to ask you what kind of clothes you've got in your closet, and whether they're fashionable or not. He is going to ask you how many people you clothed that didn't have any. God is not going to ask you how many friends that you have. He's going to ask you how many people were you a friend to. God's not going to ask in what neighborhood you live, but God's going to ask you how many people you treated as a neighbor. How did you do it? You see, we get it all mixed up. God's not going to ask us about the color of our skin. He's going to ask us about the content of our character.
Amen.
You see, we have a lot of platitudes. We have a lot of things that we say. And folks, when we help people and care for people and go out of our way to do kindness for people in the name of the Lord, Jesus says He's going to have a church then who's building a reputation that if you go to this church, you're going to find love here. In all these years of ministry, I don't know how many hours I've probably spent over the years in the intensive care waiting. Anybody ever been in the intensive care waiting room? Probably most of you, one time or another. There's something about an intensive care unit that breaks everything down. The intensive care unit, no matter what hospital you may be, is different from any other place in the world, and the people who are in the intensive care waiting area are different. They can't do enough for each other. I've never seen anybody be rude to somebody else who was waiting in an intensive care unit because we're all there because there's a major problem or a tragedy or a sickness, a death coming. Who knows what's going to happen at any moment? There was no distinction of race or class. It all melted away. A person is a father first, a black man second. The garbage man loves his wife just as much as the university professor loves his. When you're in the intensive care unit waiting room, the whole world changes because vanity and pretense go away.
Amen.
Because everybody sitting in that room is hurting. Everybody sitting in that room is expecting good news or bad. They don't know which. Everybody, the universe is focused on the next doctor's report when he comes through the door and stands in front of your family. And how many times have you sat there with the family and he's talking to another family and you overhear it's bad news? Bad news. And yet those people who are sitting in that room will rally around that person after the doctor walks away. Some will offer to have prayer. Everyone knows that loving somebody else is what life is all about. The atmosphere of the intensive care room is different than any other room in the world. I say that to say this, it seems to me that's the atmosphere we ought to be cultivating in the church. We're all in this together.
Amen.
We all have aches and pains and problems and difficulties. I got mine. You got yours. You got a horror story. I got one too. You got something bad happen to you. I had bad stuff happen to me. We've all got hurts and aches and pains. And we've all got joys. And we should rejoice when there's joy to be celebrated. But we also should come together when there's issues and problems. And we cultivate an atmosphere that's practical, an attitude of love. A good place to start, by the way, is in your own family.
Yes.
I never will forget the person that all they thought about was just what was happening to them. Other people could have stuff happen, didn't matter. It's all about me, all about me. Folks, the church, part of the church, all of us in the church, we need to be working together and showing love and exercising faith, being there for one another, and put all the other things aside.
Amen.
We're in a troubled world. It's always been troubled, and it'll keep being troubled until Jesus comes. I'm sorry to disappoint you, but folks say to me, well, maybe things will get a little bit better. Well, no, not until Jesus comes, it's going to get worse. Okay. That's just Bible. This Bible doesn't tell me it's going to get better than Jesus.
Right.
In Hebrews chapter 11, there is a great faith vision that comes as well. A willingness to trust God to take big risks. The ability to see and believe in more than meets the eye. As a church right now, you're what we might call one of those critical areas that we get to in church. We a pastor that you love, he retired, he's gone, made his way, and you're in a critical state right here. From a standpoint of you've got to be praying, you've got to be coming together, you've got to be joining and doing whatever God's Word tells you to do so that you get the right man to come.
Amen.
The right person to be your pastor, the right person to step in and carry you to the next step until Jesus comes. Listen. The Bible says we need to see and believe in more than meets the eye. Hebrews chapter 11 has always been a blessing. And what shall I say more for the time would fail me to tell of Gideon and Barak and Samson and Jephthah, of David and Samuel and the prophets, who through faith subdued kingdoms, wrought righteousness, obtained promises, stopped the mouth of lions, quenched the violence of fire, escaped the edge of the sword, out of weakness were made strong, waxed valiant in the fight, and turned the flight of enemies and the armies of the aliens. Faith. I read about a fellow that went to court. You know, some people want to change their name sometimes. This fellow went to court. He wanted his name changed. He went before the judge. He said, the judge asked him a question. He said, well, he said, what is your name now? And he said, William Stinks. Well, the judge kind of laughed to himself when he heard that. He said, well, I don't blame him for wanting to change his name. So he said that under his breath. Then he said, the judge did again in a loud voice. He said, sir, he said, what do you want to change your name to? He said, Bill Stinks. Well, we got to think better than that. And a little bit bigger than that, haven't we? How do we enlarge our vision? How do you enlarge your vision? How does this church, when you walk with the giants, you walk with the people of great vision, you let them rub off on you. You look and see the people in the Bible and what God did in their lives over and over again. We need to lift our eyes as a church to a power that is greater than ourselves and pray every day for God to show us the way. God has a man, this last man, he didn't seem to be working out, and there's probably disappointment there, but the other side of the coin is God's got somebody, and if it wasn't him, you're better off without him. I don't mean that ugly. I'm just saying God's got a man, but you come together as a church and you pray and you have faith and you look beyond what you can see.
Amen.
We have a great big God, and so I think that means you need to have some great big dreams. Yes. You have a lot going for you. When I look around and this morning, I'm in church, not Cranville, but it's not a bad group. Pretty good little group here this morning. And the times that I've been here, you people sing out, I've enjoyed worship because you folks actually sing. I've been in some churches, the only thing singing was the machine. You know, you worship. You know, you've got a lot of things that are strong here. And that strength came from things that Brother David was able to walk you through in the scriptures. It comes from what you're learning in the Sunday school. I was tickled to death seeing these little youngins, even though they run off and left my sermon. I'll preach to their. I was going to be nice to my children's sermon, but I don't know. First time I got walked out on 4 a.m. open my mouth. Happened after me. Anyway. We need to be like the verse in the Bible that says, Lord, I believe, but help my unbelief. Help me, Lord, with the things I'm struggling with right now. I'm concerned. I have, you know, some things going on in my head, and I want the church to do the right thing and be the right thing. Folks, you can be all of that more than you ever imagined if we just exercise great faith and not have the church going loose. I get so tired of running into people that won't make me feel bad because all I've got is Jesus. I'm serious. I run into folks every day that try to make me feel bad because all I've got is Jesus. Understand that Jesus is all you need.
Amen.
He's all you've ever needed. He's all you need right now. He's all you'll ever need for the future. He knows what you need and he knows exactly how you need him. And our responsibility is to give ourselves to him and his word. And you'll be amazed at what God can do. Way far beyond what you've ever done before. Don't be guilty of having the church going blues. God has so much more. And God wants you to be right in the middle of what he's doing. And you do that by having great faith. Man, Paul said, I can't wait to come see you folks because they're talking about your faith all over the world. Look what it's doing. Look what it's accomplishing. It can be that way in Green Pond Baptist Church if we look to him who is our creator, the author and the finisher of our faith. Father, as we come to you in prayer, we thank you, Lord, for loving us. Lord, for being everything we need or will ever need. And I pray that you would, Lord, that this church would continue to be a praying church and a Bible reading and believing church. And Lord, that great faith and great works, Lord, will be spread throughout the neighborhood, throughout this area, that this is a place to want to come and to see what God's going to do next, because you're that kind of a God. And I want us, Lord, to think about being and carrying it forward beyond thinking, to be the kind of people that folks want to be near and to be around. Thank you, Lord, for all that you'll continue to do in this fellowship. For the children, Lord, back in children's church, I know that, Lord, there's some things to do to have fun as well. But Lord, they're learning. Those people are working hard to teach them in a way the children can understand your word. And Lord, it may be the little children that lead us. If that's the way it works, then so be it. But let us be willing and grateful for all that you'll do and look to you for all that you'll need. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's stand and you come and do what the Lord tells you to do, would you?
We invite you to look in your hymnal. We've changed it from what's in the bulletin to hymn number 312, Softly and Tenderly. having trouble with the other kids to play, but we invite you, the Lord invites you to come. We sing.
God is leading us, and we're trusting Him and we have asked him not to let us get in his way, that we be patient, and we will stick together.
That's
right. And go through this together. And I think Brother Cove, that's an awesome thing that he stepped up to do, being in this together. And that we would continue to thank him. We'll close, and we'll ask favors for the church for my father right now. So let's all go together. Heavenly Father, we're so thankful for this opportunity that you have given us to come together as we should every Sunday come together with all of our loving brothers and sisters who love one another, embrace one another, encourage one another. And dear Lord, I ask from my heart this morning a favor for each one, that you would touch each and every person here this morning in a mighty way. Reassure them that you're still on the throne, that nothing happens unless it comes directly from your throne. And we thank you for the mighty words, your mighty words, that came through your Holy Spirit, through Brother Cove this morning. And we had receptive hearts, that we would store the words that he conveyed to us this morning in our hearts, that we will go forth this next week, that we pray that someone will see Jesus in us, that we can stop along the way and help a brother that's down, dear Lord, and lift them up through our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Please continue to be with them, each and every one of us, dear Lord. Please see to our prayer list. Lend a favor to it, dear Lord, would you please? And we'll give you all the honor and the glory and the thanks that you so richly deserve. And everybody said, amen.
Amen.
Oh, yeah.